a story of one of my experiences whilst on holidays in Tea Gardens down on Jimmy's Beach with a friend of mine who was living here at the time, who'd got into a little thing called kite surfing. And so I thought I'd give it a go, and my spine has only just recovered from that attempt. I shared that story last time, and so to try and redeem a little bit of any credibility I may have, I thought I'd share a story of a more successful boarding experience that I had. And we have to go back quite a way now, to when I was 17. Now, I was learning to surf at 17, and where I come from, that's a late bloomer. In fact, I was watching Point Break last night, and the guy was picking up at 25, was trying to surf at 25, and a young kid in the surf shop said, well, that's okay, it's never too late. And at 17, 18, I felt like pretty much the same. Most of my friends had been surfing as long as they'd been swimming. But for me, I was a late bloomer. I grew up in Narara on the Central Coast, which is not exactly coastal. We were renowned for all sorts of things. So if anyone's locked your keys in your car, I can probably help you. But I was not so much for surfing. So a lot of my friends were, and we moved closer to the coast, and so I thought I'd pick up surfing, and this is not a photo of me at any shape or stage of my surfing career, but I want to talk to you a little bit about my early surfing experience. The wave that you kind of see here is a wave that's breaking. You can kind of, I apologise, it's not a great quality, but you can kind of see in towards the centre around the foam. I can see a surfer, and he's in exactly the right kind of spot of where he wants to be. He's kind of in where the wave's breaking. If he pulls up a little bit, he'll kind of be in the barrel, which is kind of the aim of surfing. It's kind of like the pinnacle of what you're trying to achieve, short of signing a sponsorship deal. Now, for me, I'd been surfing for about 6 months to 9 months, and I'd kind of been getting okay. I could paddle out, I wasn't drowning as often, and I was really feeling like I was starting to make it. And my friends at this time, who'd been surfing since swimming, had been very patient with me, very graceful with me. They were calling me onto waves, giving me advice, cheering me on, letting me have some of the waves coming through. And I knew that the day that I'd made it, and that I must be doing okay, because they stopped doing that. They stopped saying, good on you, you're trying, you're giving it a go. And one of my mates said to me one time, in this wave came through, it was quite a nice wave that came through, and I thought I'd caught it, and I thought I'd done quite well, and I paddled back out, and he looked me in the eye, and he said, if you keep wasting waves, I'm going to drop in on you every time from now on. Well, what do you mean? I'm standing up, the wave's kind of pushing me along, I'm doing fine, I'm surfing, right? And he's like, no, that's not surfing. See, I was sitting out on the shoulder, you see where the guy in the jet ski is? That's kind of what I was doing. I was like, paddle, 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 yay, the wave's moving me, I stood up, aren't I wonderful? And he said, no, that's not surfing. Surfing's sitting deep, where the danger is. Surfing, sitting in the impact zone where the guy we can kind of see near the foam is. And I'm like, but that's incredibly dangerous. And Mick looked at me in the eye and he said, no, that's surfing. That's surfing. Now, as I've thought over my own Christian faith over the past 20 years, I think that there's been plenty of times in my life where I felt like I was surfing. Where, hey, I was going through the motions, I was doing the things I needed to do. I was standing up, I was wearing the wetsuit, you know, I was turning up to church, I was serving in some kind of ministries, I was doing some good things, and I'd stopped doing some bad things. And I thought, hey, this is it. This is the Christian life. This is what it looks like. Every year for those 20 years that I've been following Jesus, I've tried to stop and take stock at the start of the year. Not so much a New Year's resolution, sort of, you know, I've given up on the losing weight one and I've given up on a few of the others, but I like to ask the idea of, I've successfully quit smoking for the past 36 years now, which is great. I haven't picked that up, but I've kind of, instead of trying resolutions, I just sort of want to stop and take stock a little bit and ask Jesus, what is it that he's saying to me? what is it that he's kind of wanting for me this year? And I hope that I'm not alone in that. I don't really mind when you do it, or what calendar changeover, or what date, or whatever significant milestone is for you, but I would hope that however long you've been following Jesus, you've been continuing to ask him that question. Of Jesus, is there anything I can be doing to follow you more closely? Is there anything I can do? Is there anything you're calling me to that I'm missing, or that I'm looking for? I'm going to pray now and ask that if God has been speaking to you about something, that as we open his word together today, that you'll hear from him. And hear in specific and doable kind of ways what it is that Jesus is speaking to you. Would you mind praying to you? Father, we thank you that we gather here this morning. Thank you that we gather with a living and active word in front of us. Lord, that's not just a record, but it's a letter to us. It's an alive document. Lord, you want to speak to us this morning. You've already spoken to us this morning as we've worshipped and as we've opened your word and as we've talked to each other. Lord, but I pray that you would open our hearts to what you might be saying to us. Lord Jesus, I get the sense that for some of us, you're calling us to sit a bit deeper. Lord, I pray that as we open your word and unpack it this morning, Lord, I pray that you would speak to each and every one of us individually. Lord, I only know a handful of people here, but you know everyone. You know that every way from forward, every moment. So I pray that you would speak to them, what it is you have for them. Not just this morning or this year, but in the life that you've given us. That you've given us. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The passage we look at this morning is probably a fairly familiar one. It's from John 21, but I want to explore three movements of this story. You've got your Bible there, you want to open it. I'm going to be jumping around a little bit, but I'm going to pick up a few passages from this one story. And we talk about it as the restoration of Peter. Next couple of slides, please. Have we got those verses? Maybe they're not happy. Oh, there they go. Now, in this story, we find all these little narrative details that sort of just don't seem like much at first. We see things like when they finished eating. When they landed, there was a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus saying to them, come and have breakfast. All these things, which kind of just seem like narrative detail. Jesus coming, taking the bread and giving it to them, doing the same with the fish. This stuff that in Scripture, sometimes when we're familiar with it, when we're familiar with the stories and the words, we jump over it. It's just kind of like filling in the bits and pieces of information, kind of painting some lines where the real stuff kind of happens. One of the things I was challenged on a couple of years ago was to actually slow down with my reading of Scripture, not to kind of get to the end of the story, but to notice what's happening. I want to read you I'll read you the whole chapter we're looking at in context. I'm going to go through it. Oh, I might jump back. I'm going to read you the whole of Scripture. I want you to listen out for these kind of details in the story. When they finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you're old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, follow me. Powerful story, isn't it? Now, in the midst of this story, we sort of see some of these details of breakfasts and fires, and we just jump over them and try and get to the good bits. But let's just put it in context a little bit. Where this story is happening is at Jesus' bodily resurrection. Scholars say that Jesus spent about 2 weeks going around and meeting with the disciples, meeting with them, appearing to others in bodily form before he sort of went back to heaven. So we see this really brief kind of window in history we're talking about here. See, from here, Peter and the other disciples will go and they'll launch the church. They'll launch that movement which you and I sit in line of 2,000 odd years later. So we see this brief window of time between where Jesus is physically with the disciples and where the disciples are about to kind of launch out and do it without him being physically there. And in the midst of this briefest snippet of time, this time of human history with these two overlapping eras of eternity there for just a few weeks, not even a speck in the timeline of the universe, in this unique and special time where Jesus is establishing the church, he's sending out the disciples to go and take his message from just the message that he preached himself to the message that would be here being spoken about in tea gardens 2,018 odd years later. In this brief window and snippet of time, what do we see Jesus spending his time doing? Yeah, he's speaking to the disciples and making some appearances. But he makes them breakfast. Jesus takes the time to make breakfast for his friends. I don't know about you, but that blows my mind. Sometimes I don't make breakfast for myself because I think I'm too busy. You know, I get so caught up in the importance of myself, in my own little world, my own little kingdom, those things that I want to kind of get done in a day that's on my to-do list, that when my kids say, "Hey, Dad, can we have brekkie?" I say, "Oh, I haven't got time. I have to make it myself." And who am I? Jesus, the creator of the universe, 1 John 1 tells us all, makes his whole story for us. He was there in the beginning. Through him all things were created. Revelation wraps up the story by talking about this picture of the returning, all-conquering king, right? The God who always was and always will be. That Jesus grabs some sticks and some bread and some fish, and he makes breakfast for his friends. I know it just seems like narrative detail, and I don't want to draw a great theology out of it, but don't we get a beautiful picture of Jesus? What he cares about, what his values are. The importance of relationship to him, I think, is so abundantly clear here, isn't it? I don't know about you, but if I had that much time, if I was about to launch a movement that would go on for a few thousand years, I'd have a PowerPoint presentation ready at least, right? Some job descriptions, I'd set up portfolios, I'd have the whole thing ready to roll out. Jesus made breakfast. And I think what we see from this is the importance of relationship to Christ. Importance of all that they will do and all that they will achieve, all that Peter will go on to become and do for Jesus' sake. I believe Jesus wanted it to come from a place of relationship. So the breakfast isn't just the scenery. It reveals an important truth to us. And that is, if we want to be following in the work of Jesus, that relationship with him matters. That relationship is central to him. Now, about once a year I get to go and visit the work of our partners. I'm actually off to the Philippines this Thursday. I get to go and sort of see the great work that our Christian partners overseas are doing. So anytime you give to a Be Hope offering or you give to you sponsor a child, any work like that, the implementation of it is done by our Christian partners overseas in different countries. So I don't go and do a whole lot overseas, but I do get to go and visit once a year. Every time I go, I have this, I'm an active kind of person, not maybe physically, but at least kind of mentally. I'm an activist, you would say, not in the sign-carrying sense, but in the just, if there's something to be done, I just want to do it. I just want it to be done. Reflection isn't my strength, action is. and it's also my weakness. So when I go and I have this once a year trip to go and see what our partners are doing and to meet them, I'm always ready to go. It's always like I've kind of got my ADD kind of ramps up, and I'm like, I've had some red cordial and I want to kind of touch down in these countries. I'm like, right, let's hit the ground running. I want to get out and see some villages, and we get some photos and some stories from my sermons, and all this kind of stuff to do. Maybe we'll get to kind of share the gospel. What Jones is all going to be incredible. And I find the partners always are invariably just kind of like, maybe we should have lunch first. And I'm like, lunch? What? I've got time for lunch as a universe to save. I'm here now, right? But what I've learned from these guys over the past few trips that I've done, and hopefully I'll remember this Thursday when I touch down, is the importance of relationship. Next photo. So the top, you see some guys in the Solomon Islands, and we were driving out to these projects. And the whole way we just chatted life and faith and the things that we had in common. And they would say at the end of the trip that was, and I would probably say as well, that was one of the most impacting times. And the left here, I mean, apologise, I've taken these photos. You ever taken a photo of a prayer time? It's like the most awkward thing you ever do. But I wanted to catch it, because we're there, we're standing in one of the community centres out in rural Cambodia, ready to go. There's so much need around us. We've got, you know, the resources to kind of meet that need. And these guys wanted to pray. They wanted to stop and pray. And I think that I need that reminder. We need that reminder. To stop and foster that relationship with Jesus. I get around a lot and working for a development agency sometimes, it's a pretty polarizing thing, and people kind of say, oh, so you just kind of care about mission, or just, you know, what are you doing to encourage people's discipleship? Or, and sometimes you get asked that question, well, so are you more excited about discipleship or mission? I sort of say to people, well, are you more excited about inhaling or exhaling? Which is it that you're most passionate about? Because honestly, if you're doing one, you can't do the other. You just can't. No, it doesn't work. Either way, I can't do it the other way. I don't have lung capacity. But it's mission and discipleship. They kind of feed off each other. If you're focused on your discipleship, if you want to know about following Jesus, if you want to be walking in the footsteps of Jesus, which is my understanding of what discipleship means, you will be led to mission. Jesus is God doing mission to us. So if we're following him, if we're walking after him, we'll be doing mission. And by the same token, if you're like me, you're an activist, you're like kind of doing stuff, one of the things you'll learn, one of the things I've learned sometimes the hard way, that is if I start doing my discipleship, my mission just becomes activity. My mission just becomes doing good stuff and stop being real mission. And this is why we see this story. Jesus doesn't say to Peter, you're going to sit here forever with me, we're just going to have breakfast all the time. But when before he launches him out, he wants it to come from him. He wants it to do it. He wants Peter to do it. I believe he wants us to do it with the smell of breakfast in our nostrils, with the taste of the bread and the fish still on our tongue. Remembering that all that we do out of a place of relationship with Jesus. Having rebuilt the connection that was kind of shattered between Peter and Jesus, we see this kind of amazing moment. where they'd finished eating, and Peter and Jesus asked him these three questions. Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? If you're not familiar, you might want to have a look back at the story of Matthew 16, 18, where Simon Peter hits the peak of his understanding. He declares that Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus tells him that he is Peter, the rock, and on that rock he will build his church. And yet, the story unravels. Peter has always been the blustery one, the one I relate to a little bit too much. It says, even if everyone else falls away, and there's some riffraff around me, right? You know, some of these guys, I don't doubt, are going to fall away, Jesus. But don't worry. I've got this. Everyone else goes, I'll be there. And of course, as the story plays out, they do fall away one by one. Until we see Peter standing in a courtyard outside where Jesus is facing a kangaroo trial. And he gets asked three times. You must, your accent, you must know the Galilean inside of the trial. Second time, it's asked again. It cannot be a coincidence. You must know Jesus. No, I don't. I don't know what you're talking about. And that third time, Simon Peter, the rock, the one who said, even if everyone else falls away, I will stay. And I was the third time in the background. The rooster crows. And Peter remembers those words that Jesus said. You'll deny me three times. So Jesus doesn't have a hearing problem or a stutter here. He asks him this question three times. Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? For the third time, I think that Peter gets it. And that's when he feels hurt, because he remembers. Now, when I was an early Christian, I became Christian as a teenager, and at 16, 17, you know everything. That peaks at 22. You start realising maybe you don't know everything. But up in between then, I had it all sorted. I miss those days of certainty sometimes. But I think in my early Christian days especially, I thought of, here's a sporting analogy, I thought of Jesus as the referee. The one who was there waiting to blow the whistle every time I made a mistake. The one who was wanting to point out to me how far short I was falling. Mistakes I was still making, sin I was still trapped. And the opportunities that I was letting go. Put him as a referee with a divine kind of whistle of guilt. Now, as I've become a better Christian a little bit longer, as I've spent some time with some great older mentors, a picture's kind of emerged to me more than of Jesus as a coach. That's not saying he doesn't point out mistakes. That's not saying that, you know, when I fall into a sin or I miss an opportunity or I do something wrong, that Jesus doesn't let me know and want me to know. But I believe in this story and in my own life and probably some lives here, we get a sense that more Jesus isn't about wanting to blow the whistle of guilt, but to help us play the game better, help us be better followers of him. Oh, I still get called up on plenty of things. Same way, Jesus wants to remind Peter that, you know, that arrogance, that confidence, that sense of overinflated sense of importance in yourself, that's not going to be very helpful in this next phase of ministry I'm called into. Seems to me that what Jesus is giving Peter here is one of those beautiful gifts of a do-over. The chance just to have another go at something. I coached my daughter's soccer team this year, and one of the things that I was really big on was when they made a mistake, when they forget and they pick up the ball, or they go to do a throw in and couldn't do it right. Rather than just kind of punish them straight away because they're six, I'd look at the other coach and he'd look back at me and we're like, and we'd go, try again, sweetheart. Just remember to use your feet this time.
And all those little soccer details. And I think that that's what Jesus is doing here. Restoring Peter, giving him a chance, where he launches out into this mission. That's not to say, as we look at this next story, that Jesus actually hasn't set a pretty high bar. So that's not where it stops. And I guess my worry is in a lot of Western Christianity today, that often is where it stops. Jesus wants a relationship with you, and he will take care of your sin and guide you gently while you sit and wait for him to come back. This sense that we've kind of been given, we're cleansed, we're clean, and now we just have to sort of sit and wait. Well, as we see this journey that Jesus is walking with Peter, it seems to me there's a third step, and it's a pretty dramatic one. It's where every time that Peter says, you know I love you, well, Jesus says, okay, then feed my sheep. There's an application for it. If you love me, don't just get a nice, warm, gushy feeling about it and sing quite some songs and kind of gather once a week to talk to other people about how nice that is. What he wants to do, I believe, to say to us, and what he says to Peter so clearly here, is, well, if you love me, that's going to make a difference in how you do life. It's going to change the shape of how you do things. Feed my sheep, he says. And if we think that that's just a vague pastoral kind of reference, we follow the Good Shepherd, and when the Good Shepherd in Luke 4:18-19 talks about what his life and his shepherding is going to look like, he says this: the Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he's anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour. If we're going to feed the sheep, tend to the sheep, look after the sheep in the way of the Great Shepherd, that's what it looks like. That's what it looks like. Goes on to say that that's not going to be a cheap and easy thing. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you were old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Church history tells us that that was to the point of crucifixion for Peter. Jesus said this, though, not as a warning, but to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would what? Glorify God. Then he said to him, follow me. Somehow in the midst of that suffering and that discomfort, that is how God is glorified in Peter's life and in everyone's. That's strange and so counterintuitive to the world that we live in. All those messages that whisper in our ear of pursuing comfort and a good life and an easy life. Jesus whispers another word. Follow me, even if it's costly, and so that it is costly. Now in our Western world today, look, I mean, I live in a house with a pool and air conditioning, right? And sometimes I just wonder what to do. I'm going to pile it all up and sell it. I don't know. So I'm not by any means saying, hey, the guy who knows exactly what to do is here and is here to tell you. But as a fellow journeyer, fellow traveller, and someone who hasn't travelled as long as many of you here, I do know that there should be something about my life and something about our life that is sacrificial. That says, yes, but. Yes, I know that that could make my life easier. Or I know that it could make me more popular. Or it could make me more comfortable. It could make me all these sorts of things which the world tells me need to be. But Jesus calls us to a different life. And when we do that, we glorify God. It's not easy to do. Actually, over Christmas, and Sue and I have been emailing me about this, over Christmas, I actually got really sick. I was quite
generally I'm pretty well. Actually, I've never spent a night in hospital until this year. And then I had surgery on the 11th of December, pretty routine surgery, no problems. See you guys all on the 14th of January. I'll be up and at it and off to the Philippines doing all the kind of things I always kind of been ready to do. And then on the 23rd of December, I started feeling sick. And I thought, oh, this is a bit inconvenient. We're off to Canberra tomorrow to see the family. I've got a 5-hour drive. I'll just duck up to the hospital, grab some antibiotics. Well, I was going to just go to the doctors, but of course, I'm a guy, sorry, or I'm at least this type of guy, who decides that they'll just see it through until it gets to midnight on the 23rd of December and they realise there are no doctors open and that denial is not going to get you through this one. So you think, I'll just duck up quickly to the hospital, I'll grab some antibiotics, maybe a cold flannel, and I'll be fine. I arrive, they take my pulse, my temperature, and they say, settle in, my friend. I've gone septic, had septicemia from the surgery. So on Christmas Eve, so I went up and I just whispered to my wife here, and I said, oh, I'm just going to go and think I'll be back soon. My phone dies while I'm up there because I'm that prepared. I'm that confident I'm only going to be a few hours, right? And on the 24th of December, the emergency department calls my wife and says, you better come up. And so it's this kind of, this shock kind of experience, right? So for next, so I spent Christmas Day, Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, Boxing Day, and the 27th in hospital, having never spent a night in hospital. And I thought, I was pretty disappointed in God, if I'm honest. I was like, this is not what it's supposed to be like, Lord, you know? It's Christmas Day. I should be home with my three kids. I should be doing all this kind of stuff. And I think I experienced for the first time in my life, and for a long way, some of that sense of, oh, what's this all about? What's this all for? But it was amazing in that time, the opportunity I had over the course of Christmas, and no private health insurance because I'm that cocky, right? So I'm sharing this ward with four other people, and I just had a reality check of what life looks like for a lot of people that I've forgotten about. Even people in our own country. People who had no one to come visit on Christmas Day. People who are a long way from home or pretty close to the end of their time. And I think I'm still processing it, if I'm honest with you. I didn't even know I was necessarily going to share this morning. But I think that I've become a bit addicted to comfort. And anything that breaks that addiction offends me. Anything that calls me to something other than the nice little plan I've got laid out offends me. But what I'm realising, what I want to do this year, realise that I can glorify God in the midst of suffering. In fact, that's part of the plan. So I had a chance to share a little bit with some of my doctors and some of the other people in my ward, and I don't know what difference that'll make in the grand scheme of things. But I know that it reminded me that this addiction to comfort doesn't come from God. And in case I needed another reminder, I received one of the hardest things you have to do in my role, because we do a lot of trial sponsorship, which some of you know, is sometimes with about 10 or 12,000 children sponsored around the world, sometimes the worst happens for those kids. And you get a letter and have to ring a donor and let them know that the worst has happened. I hope none of you have received that phone call, because it's a terrible call. It's a major to receive. And I realised on the 20th, I received this letter just to go back to work, and I realised the exact same day I went into hospital, where I had a team of surgeons looking after me. I had nurses. I was fed. I left and I paid $5.40 for 4 days worth of parking. That was all it cost me. At the same time as that, there was one of the sponsored children in Uganda went to his local hospital on the 23rd of December and didn't come back out. You know, our comfort's not real. Or it is real, but it's not. It's not the only reason. I guess my challenge for myself this year is,
what am I going to do to step out of my comfort zone and break my addiction to comfort? And I wonder if God might be asking some others of that. And I don't know exactly what that looks like. We were completely honest, like I say, and I can't hear you guys. So it's kind of over, going to be over to God to know what that looks like. But I encourage you, we're only the 14th of January. Maybe ask Jesus to speak to you what he's asking you to do. I'm actually going to provide an opportunity to do that, hopefully just with a video and some music. It's not a sales video. It's just an opportunity for you guys to stop and pause and ask God what he might be saying to you about the world that we live in, and that can be lovely or global. After the video, I'll stop and pray, and I encourage you to please come and have a chat with me.